Tele? Okay. Vaibhav?
Vaibhav is
Not there, no? Okay.
not there.
That's all. So, welcome you all back after 1 week. Let's start our day with our vernacular class. I hope my voice is clear to you all. On your side?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. If you want anything, you can stop me. Just put it in the chat box or you can unmute yourself. But please try to mute when the class is going on so that there won't be any disturbances for the others. The last class, we started with the introduction of vernacular architecture. I hope you all remember. Where vernacular architecture is a term which is used to categorize the methods of construction, which uses the locally available resources to address the local needs. I request you all to mute your microphone, please.
Yes, sir.
Please mute your microphone. Yes, Rahul. I marked, ma. Okay, so vernacular architecture, where we have studied about how this is used in architecture out of using the local building materials and technology, the climate responsive and the reflection of the customs and the lifestyle of the community of the people living. So this subject mainly aims at does not aim only at the good aesthetics, it also aims at the comfort and using of the natural light materials, where it is used by everyone, and that is what we studied about the definition and the aim of vernacular architecture. And we also the main need for the study of this subject is I mean study certain principles of design based on knowledge of traditional practices, where it is usually self-built, as I already said, easy to learn and understand. Predominantly, they use only the local materials, the local climate. They have to fit within the local climate, flora, fauna, and the ways of life, etc. So this research generally, seeks way to document the traditional vernacular principles. So there is always difference between a vernacular and the traditional, as I said in the previous class. So vernacular architecture may be adopted and refined into culturally accepted solution, but only through the repetition it becomes traditional. So whereas traditional architecture, which includes all the temple palaces, so this, for example, which will not be included usually in the rubric of vernacular. So traditional architecture always includes all the temples and palaces, etc. Also, so this is a major difference between the vernacular and the traditional. So I will present my screen now. Sasidharan and Hemlata. Okay, Ma, I'll mark you. Sasidharan, I've already marked. Hemlata, I'll mark.
Ma'am,
Yes.
Nandakumar present, ma'am.
Yarpa, Kekla.
Nandakumar present,
Ah,
ma'am.
okay, Ma. Okay, I'll mark you.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you, Ma. Just let me know if my screen is visible. Is the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. So today, I think we started with few presentations in the last class. Today we'll mainly look into the main themes of vernacular architecture, the derivations, the definitions of it, the contrast between how the vernacular and the architects are associated, and how the contrast, how they defined each and every architect defined the vernacular architecture as. We'll be studying about the broad study about it and what are the influences on the vernacular and what are the different typologies. And you will also be studying about the influence factors which shapes the vernacular architecture. We'll be looking into the components of vernacular architecture, the basic study, how you need to study the vernacular architecture and the methodology being used, and how vernacular as a cultural acts as a cultural and contextual response to everyone. So you can look at this as an image you can see from around the world in South Africa. The next image you should see is a Maasai house at Tanzania. The third we see, this is a house from Timbuktu. All these are the images of the vernacular. And you can see the next image at Italy. All these are around the world. And the last one is a Black House at Scotland. So we had a quick look at the five houses from around the world. Now I will take you closer to a few examples at home, that is within our India. Dungas, which I said in the last class on the which is located in the Kashmir, which is a boat house. The next one is the Havelis in Gujarat. You can just take a look at all these images at closer home. And here in Kerala and Tamil Nadu, we call it as a Agraharams. And the fourth is a mansion in Chettinad, which is all the examples. Now we had a quick look at all these images. So now we'll move on to the, we've already seen this, but just to recap from the old class, certain definitions and derivations. In order to understand any field or any study, any specific character of any study, you need to look at the words and the derivations, where this word has been derived from. So when you look at vernacular architecture, let us look at how the word has been derived. So this has been derived from the vernaculars, meaning domestic, native, and indigenous. So varna meaning native slave or home-born slave. So in the field, again, the study of linguistics or of home-born means. So your vernacular language refers to a language used particular to that particular time, place, or a group, as we seen in the last class. So these are all some of the derivations. So this helps us to draw closer to understanding the study. So now we look into the direct definitions of the vernacular architecture. So I've started out with a very critical definition, but one from the renowned architect. So he had defined vernacular architecture as the folk building growing in response to the actual needs, fitting into the environment by people who knew no better than to fit them with native feeling. So this is rather a very critical way of defining vernacular architecture by an architect. So it, nevertheless, it's a definition. This is rather a critical way of defining vernacular architecture. The next definition is by a very certain person called Ronald, who's an English academic who has done extensive study in British vernacular architecture. So he has defined the vernacular architecture as a building designed by an amateur, again, without any training in design. The individual will have been guided by a series of conventions built up in his locality, paying very little attention to what may be fashionable, that is aesthetics. Very less attention is being concentrated to the aesthetics. So I would like you to take a key note on the word fashionable. That plays an important role in this definition which he has given. So the next definition, the function of the building would be the dominant factor, aesthetic consideration to some degree, and then present to some small degree being quite minimal, very minimal amount of aesthetic considerations. Local materials would be used as a matter, of course. Other materials being chosen and imported quite perceptually is a definition given by, Ronald Bronskill. So these are, if you look at these keywords without training in design, little attention to what may be fashionable, the function of the building, and the local materials, all these are some of the keywords that are to appear throughout vernacular architecture. And they also define what vernacular architecture is all about. So we looked into different critical definitions, and that is what for you to understand vernacular architecture a bit more critically. So the next architect, moving on to the next definition. So I would also like to mention what vernacular architecture, some definitions given by Ethel Wright. So you can just go through this. So to mention about what vernacular architecture is not, it is also important to understand what something is not, so as to get closer to the understanding what it is. So vernacular architecture is not something that is designed by architect. This can be quite ambiguous. Nevertheless, it's more accurate because architects usually put a lot of time into design, have a premeditated notion, but vernacular is not so. So architecture designed by architects is usually not termed as vernacular architecture. That is what is meant by what is not in the first thing. Though which is being followed a lot, and good practice would be to incorporate these features in our present times. So vernacular architecture is simply the nature of approach that defines it. That is what we need to study in this. So furthermore, about vernacular architecture, used to categorize the methods of construction, which uses the locally available resources, the traditions to address the local needs, and it also tends to evolve over the time and also reflects, that is very important, it reflects the environmental cultural aspect with a specific time, again, indigenous architecture with specific time or place. Also, it has to have some historical context which exists within it. Yeah. Is it visible? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. When you study vernacular architecture from the past, you know it applies to residential building as well as in the dwellings, in contrast to the planned architecture by architects. The building knowledge in vernacular architecture is often transported by local tradition and is more not only based on knowledge achieved by trial and error method. So always by the trial and error method only they achieve that. So it is transported by the local tradition, often handed down to the generations rather than calculated on the basis of geometry and physics. So some of the books to ponder, again, looking into the basic major books which we need to ponder about architecture without architects by Bernard Rudofsky, Encyclopedia of Vernacular Architecture of the World by the Paul Oliver. So these are the two important books which helps you to understand the system, the structure which you can apply to study the vernacular architecture. So this is all about the general vernacular architecture, which we studied in the definition before in the previous class. Moving on to the next topic, we need to know the relationship between the vernacular and the architect. So what is the contrast? So I would like you to consider these two images. Just look at these images. One on the left is in the Britain, that is British colonial architecture. The image on the right is from England, but it is of vernacular architecture. Look both of them together, you will understand visually what I mean, which is self-explanatory. This is based on geometrical technicalities. A lot goes into the aesthetic appeal, while the image on the right is based on what a person needs at that particular moment, on a very local and a temporary base. So this is what is a major difference between the contrast between the architecture and the vernacular architecture. The left is your architecture, the right is your vernacular architecture. So I've taken you through how an architect defines vernacular architecture in the words of Wright already, F.L. Wright. As I said earlier, Encyclopedia of Vernacular Architecture is a good way to start. So as if you look at the first paragraph, the Paul Oliver, what he has said, is an important person who contributes to the study of the vernacular architecture. In his words, it has been contended that popular architecture designed by professional architects or commercial builders according to Paul Oliver, it is contended that popular architecture designed by professional architects or commercial builders for popular use does not come within the compass of the vernacular. So this is again being contrasted with the polite architecture, which is characterized by the stylistic element of design incorporated for the aesthetic purpose that go beyond the functional requirement. So this is the most primary point. When we talk about vernacular architecture, a person identifies his needs. He puts some methods and principles to address his needs with the local available material and gets his work done. So while in the terms of architecture to incorporate the stylish elements, which may or may not be functional, they do serve functional purposes. They also appeal a lot to the aesthetic need at the present. So this may be a bit shocking, as I said before, but it is very true. Only 1 in 10 of the building in which we live or work are designed by architects, as I said in the previous class. Contrary to the very despise of the architects practicing architecture here, it is true of how buildings are not always designed by architects. Only 1 in 10 buildings are designed by architects, and a huge part of the world's architecture is vernacular. The rest of the architecture may or may not fall under vernacular, but it certainly isn't architecture. The rest of the world, as you see, everyone does not employ on architecture, but what they do is they address their own needs. They come up with a building, they address their own needs. So many modern architects, if you see, they have studied the vernacular architecture and claim to draw inspiration from them, including the aspects of the vernacular architecture in their design. As I said earlier, even though Wright has mentioned before, even though it has been an intellectual intelligent work in this terms of building, it can be used to study the ongoing evolution, the reasons for which the building gets shape, and the various other factors like the climate, the available materials, the social, the cultural and economical aspects. Well, may not be termed as vernacular. So you study the approach and the concepts of vernacular, which helps them to understand the culture, context, and the climate. Here are some of the examples of how architects have looked at the vernacular architecture as an example, as a way to study and how they have incorporated in the buildings. So one example is Hassan Fathi, who is an architect who works primarily in Egypt. He's an architect from the times of Le Corbusier and Wright. He's an inspiration for people and who studied vernacular architecture and tried to retain the features. So he studied the traditional Nuba settlements and technologies. He had incorporated the traditional mud brick wall, again, of the Nubian settlements in his design. So an important work of Hassan Fathi would be the housing he did for thieves and the robbers. That is one of the important work. You can have a look at it, and most of his work, when you look at it, you can understand that it is a product of study, which is something from the past. The first traditional Nubian settlement and the technologies that he applied never failed. It has been a start for all his studies in his future. The experiment failed due to a variety of social and economic reasons. And some of the other studies and incorporations were from the regional modernism. There is a style prevalent in South Asia by the Geoffrey Bawa. So continuing further, another person who did a lot, but not just in terms of study, but restricted to the vernacular architecture, but he has added some modernism to it. So he's an architect from Sri Lanka, originally from England, living in Sri Lanka. He brought about the styles of architecture that is currently relevant a lot in South Asia called regional modernism. He also derived a lot from vernacular architecture. Next comes the Charles Correia and B.V. Doshi. These are the two persons or the two pioneers of the vernacular adaptations. I mean, who has adapted the local architecture into his buildings. So adaptation of the local architecture, I don't need to tell you about them because there are a lot of their works to look into it. Charles Correia and B.V. Doshi, as we all know. Next comes Sheila Shri Prakash, an architect who used rural Indian architecture as an inspiration for innovation in environmental and socially economically sustainable design and planning. On one side, vernacular architecture is good to study about in order to look into architecture and its needs better. On the other hand, to look into the future, vernacular architecture is always an inspiration. And since vernacular, it's very foundation to address the local needs, keeping the climate and culture in mind makes it a bit of a sustainable concept. So that is an example that can act as an inspiration for all the future settlements also. So here, you can see the image on the left is by Sheila Shri Prakash. The one in the middle is a Geoffrey Bawa's work. And the one on the right is a Charles. And also the Hassan Fathi, where he studied about the vernacular architecture and he brought them into the housing experiments that he has done. So these are some of the, this slide shows us the contrast between the vernacular and the architect. So moving on to the next part. So we're going to study an example, which is a Moroccan desert fortresses, where how this is being studied and how they've incorporated the vernacular elements. So we simply have an understanding of the vernacular architecture, what vernacular and the architect have in common and such things. So here this is directly applied. Here is an example of the Moroccan desert fortress. You can look at the image and you can understand that it has nothing to do with the present day architecture or architecture that involves a lot of design actually. So some of the important features where you can see it's a fortified village, you can see by the image, commonly called as the kasbahs with small windows. It is built high and close to each other. It is most directly responds to the climate, and it is a very utilitarian design. And it is a method of expression where you can show the wealth and the prosperity. And you can see the entire layout of the kasbahs, the height, orientation, the usage of the material plays an important role in the temperature regulation. It's a direct result to the climate. So this is an example where they have used a skillful adaptation to the harsh climate in the hot, arid region. So this plays, all these three important features plays a major role in the temperature regulation as well. So So here, the next presentation, the next slide talks about, we are going to talk about the influences that affect the vernacular architecture. So I want you to consider these two images, one and two. Okay. So these two, if you look at these images, you can get a rough idea about what influences the vernacular architecture. The first thing that should strike you is the materials that are used. When you look at a modern building, the materials are brutalist. That is, they rather go with the new conventional materials. These are locally confined materials that are easily available and can be put to ease easily. The next thing you notice is that they are rather temporary and are not permanent for a long time or not intended to stand for a very long time. So they just answer their needs. What is that particular need? It shows that they adapt themselves to a lot of reasons. It also helps you to understand that there are a lot of reasons that go into the making and evolution of vernacular architecture. The next thing which you consider, we need to look into is the response to the climate. That is very important. So how it is going to act as a climate response? You have a sloped roof, or which means that it is a response to the precipitation of the area. There's something called the wind tunnel. If you look into it, they are reacting to the wind that's there. The openings are not typically big or with the shutters as such, which means that these are very small and meant for the wind. These are all directly response to the climate. Next image you can see is more relevant to the Indian context. If you notice, you can look at the courtyard space. So there are gables, water bodies, and the plinth of the entire building. You can see these are all the direct responses. You raise the plinth again so that you can capture the wind. There is a water body which shows it is a reaction to the climate. In order to cool the relevant temperature of the zone, there's a water body there. So this courtyard space acts as a way to funnel the hot air upward. So it pulls up the hot air and hot air outside and brings in the cool air inside. So there are gables that brings in the light inside the building and also the way to release the hot air. So this gives you a rough idea of what influences the architecture. So we will talk about these factors influencing in detail. So the factors influencing the vernacular architecture are the climate and geological reasons, the local materials used, and the technology adopted. So the reasons are the various factors affecting the vernacular architecture would be different in different typologies. We can have a broad category and a broad look at each of them. So vernacular architecture is influenced by the great range of different aspects of human behavior. So apart from all these human behavior, excuse me. So apart from this human behavior or human intent, so it's an important part of shaping the vernacular architecture, which leads to the different building form for almost every different context. You can notice the difference between one village to the next. That's how much of the vernacular architecture's complexity is driven by. Even neighboring villages may have different approaches to the construction, the use of the dwellings. Again, the approach to the design might differ, the structural similarities in the structural forms. The way of life is very important. As I said in the previous class, the way of the life of the building occupants, the usage of the shelter, which greatly influences the building form. You talk about the occupants, the human intents, and the human needs. The size of the family units is very important. Spatial usage, the preparation of where they are going to cook, where they are going to prepare the food, where they are going to have the impact of space, and many other cultural considerations in a single space. So the single space can act as a multi-purpose space for different purposes. So all these, the size of the family unit, spatial usage, the preparation of food, interaction of people, and many other cultural considerations affect the layout and the size of the building. So you must be wondering, what cultural effects can it have on a building in particular? I'll give you one example. An Indian context, women, they're supposed to mingle with each other on various occasions of the day. They have a space for themselves. On the other side, men act as teachers and students have another set of places. When you consider these two reasons, there's always a lot of influence themselves. So there are numerous other reasons like this to shape the vernacular architecture. So this is just an example to explain the way of life. The second one, moving on to the next influence, is the culture, which also has a great influence on the appearance of vernacular building, as occupants often decorate the building in accordance with the local custom and the belief which they have. So people have different forms of shelter appropriate to the different seasons, different geographical locations. So you can't make a prototype product. Rather, it's just an evolution. Each and every place, it will vary. So people use summer spaces and winter spaces in a particular building. They make it adaptable to different climate and different cultural locations, the development of the different solutions in similar circumstances because of the cultural influences is a typical of vernacular architecture. So the culture and its effects plays an important role. Next, moving on to is the form of shelter. So the season, how it has been associated with the different aspects of socio-economic, cultural, artistic features, which has been a source of study and has thrown light on approach to the environment by the people. In order to be a good architect, in order to understand architecture better, it could be study work that you could take up because it directs you in terms of socio-economic aspect, cultural and artistic feature as well. So always when you go for a rural study also, we look into the socio-economic aspect of it, the cultural part of it. So we need to consider everything in detail. So vernacular architecture not only interests the architects and the archaeologists who can study from them, it also includes the people from the other fields also. So when you look into the first field, in the field of sociology, the intensive surveys of individual community that discovered the buildings of different people. When you talk about different people in the building, you also throw light into the different individual communities they live. Likewise, they also interest the geographers, students of the folk life, architectural historians, etc. So vernacular doesn't restrict yourself only with certain architecture alone. The different people, the sociologists, they look into the aspect of sociology. When you look into the geography, they look into in terms of geographical area. They identify the significance of the geographical factors, the development of the different region. The folk life, they look into that aspect, they reveal the architectural detailing, building practices being done, the customs which they follow, and what has been transformed. They do the research in terms of folk life. Historians, if you look, they look into the minor architectural monuments, the house of the people, etc. Moving on to the next topic, the types of vernacular architecture. So this is domestic, there is agricultural, industrial, and religious. So it started first initially with the domestic, but it can't always be restricted only to the domestic, and it moved on to the agricultural, then comes the industrial and the religious. So we'll talk about this different types of vernacular in the next part. So where the vernacular architecture, it comprises of the domestic one, which comprises of the building designed for the living. So the activity which is meant for the entire family, where they eat, they sit, they sleep, the store, etc., and other ancillary buildings like wash area, kitchen, storage, etc. So this domestic vernacular architecture generally includes the private houses, which is used for the domestic accommodation, the rest houses, the shops, etc. Agriculture, by the term itself, you can see, mostly it is apart from the farmhouse, they use the domestic ancillary space like stable, poultry, shed, cart shed, etc. In terms of industrial, it comprises of all the buildings and houses relating to such activities like wind and water mill, the corn, trees, etc. Religious, by the term itself, we know the religious building like temple, churches, mosque, etc. So these are some of the images of the residential domestic vernacular architecture.